Hello, this is Crane Song from Twitch Chat, and you're listening to Synvicta on SS Radio.
Hello, this is Sparse Vector, the creator of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, and you're listening to Synvicta on SS Radio.
This is Sailor, Mr. of the Grendel Podcast, and you are listening to Synvicta on SS Radio.
This is Chan Man V of Wednesday Night Sprites and Climbing the Ladder, and you're listening to Synvicta on SS Radio.
Hey yo, what up world? I go by the name of Tempo from Team Infinity 7, and you are listening to my brother Synvicta on SS Radio.
Hello, this is Nick Axavranish from Major League Gaming, and you're listening to Synvicta on SS Radio.
Live on Twitch TV and on the VODs here on YouTube.com, it's SS Radio! 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 And now, here's your host, Synvicta. Up, what is going on? A tremendous Tuesday evening to y'all here live and in person. It is SS Radio number 93. Today is Tuesday, September 3rd, 2013. And for some reason, the date I put 2012. I'm apparently here on Twitch, I'm living in the past, but it is September 3rd, 2013, not 2012. My name is Synvicta, the host of SS Radio, coming at you live here on twitch.tv/Synvicta, also on the VODs on my YouTube channel, youtube.com/Synvicta316. What a crazy weekend it has been, with a combination of recording, combination of PAX Seattle, and everything else going on the interwebs and internet. I have been extremely busy, but a lot of exciting things to tell you about, as well as some not so exciting things. In fact, I would say a little bit more disappointing than anything else, and I believe some of you who do follow me on my Twitter may know what I'm talking about, but I indeed will cover it. But before we go with that, I want to give an extra special shout out to everybody here in the live chat here on twitch.tv/Synvicta. If you've never seen a live showing of SS Radio, then I welcome you out here. And if you are listening to the VODs here on my YouTube channel, then I cordially invite you to come out and check out a live showing of SS Radio. We do a fun bit before, during, and after every single episode of SS Radio. Today we did see our three-time reigning champion Spirit of Fire get trounced by Sorar, who Sorar hasn't played in about 4 or 5 months, and I believe the last couple times that Sorar has played, I think we called him a dude, but I don't know if we actually ever got any true response or true confirmation, because apparently Sorar is actually a girl, and we did not know that. But again, without any sort of proof or anything like that, let's just all face it, okay? Let us all face it. There are no girls on the internet except for myself and possibly Crane Song, who is the dudeliest of all men, the manliest of all dudes, and she's a big bully. She likes to pick on me. But enough about that. Welcome out here to SS Radio number 93, and I'm going to be giving you some topics really quickly. If you've never seen a live show, then this is how I do it. I come back from 3-2-1, and then I show you the topics. So 3-2-1. There they are, the topics tonight for SS Radio number 93. I'm going to be telling you what happened with the SS Radio Open number 5, why it is canceled, and is something that I alluded to on last Thursday's show, SS Radio number 92. I will be going in-depth and let you know exactly what has happened and what will become of that. Also going to be covering, it is a more recent video that Husky has published, and I might actually upload my point of view as well. I haven't decided if I'm going to. It seems a little bit redundant. But Husky and I successfully were able to break Hearthstone after the game only being out for 3 weeks. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, go to Husky's main StarCraft channel, youtube.com/HuskyStarCraft, and you'll find out exactly what I'm talking about. It also has to do with the title of tonight's SS Radio. And then also coming at you here on SS Radio number 93, I'm going to give you an in-depth impression of Final Fantasy XIV. Even though the servers have been kind of a pain, I dare say a little bit of a pain in the past couple of days, I am still enjoying it thoroughly. I'll give you my in-depth analysis, and now that I've been playing for a week or so, it'll be more in-depth than what the first impression will be, let's put it that way. And then, of course, I'm also going to be covering up the controversy that Path of Exile has now inherited from the ire of the gamer community, which is that they recently released a new cosmetic effect that you could buy via microtransactions, which basically allows you, when you run around and when you add it to your character and you are running around in Path of Exile, It will produce little Razer logos. Razer being the actual brand Razer. So the triple green snake head logo thing that Razer has, that is now in the game. And you can imagine, gamers being gamers, how they feel about it. And I'll give you my thoughts on that as well. And then last but certainly not least, I have found my artist after a week of searching. Actually, I guess technically a week and a half of searching or so. I have found a graphics design artist, and I will tell you who it is, and I will let you know when you can start to see some of his artistic really extreme talent, because this guy, let me tell you, I am in by no way talented artistically speaking. I have very, very little musical talent. I know basics of Photoshop, and that is about it, and I guess if anything I can video edit okay, but as far as true artistic talent, the guy that I have picked and selected out of the, I actually did get quite a bit of submissions for auditions for the artist the artist job, if you want to call that, even though it's not a paying job, but I'm just going to call it a job anyway, because that's what you're going to be doing. I do appreciate everyone who did submit their portfolios. Got a lot of beautiful artwork submitted, and some of it was almost a little bit too fancy. Some of it might be a little bit too fancy, let's put it that way. But for the most part, I did get a lot of entries, and I do want to thank everyone. And if you weren't picked, again, feel free to continue to send me pictures and pieces that you have done, because who knows, I might need another one soon. And having multiple people do graphics would be pretty cool. It gives me more free time to do other things like producing content and that sort of thing. But I will talk about that at the bottom of the show, right back up to the top here on SS Radio number 93. I'm going to be diving straight into what we were talking about on Twitter not too long ago, and something I kind of alluded to on last Thursday. Basically, with the SS Radio Open number 5, the Platinum and Diamond tournament that was supposed to be happening this coming weekend has been canceled. I have officially decided to cancel the tournament due to lack of, without no pun intended, lack of a better word, lack of interest in the tournament. At the time of me closing the tournament, I believe we had 13 people sign up, and it fell short, way short, below my expectations as far as getting people signed up. There was going to be a 32-player tournament, and I was expecting to be probably around 40 to 45 people who signed up. I was going to inflate the player pool to 64 players, and that way everyone is allowed to play. And we definitely definitely fell way short, let's put it that way. So I do want to thank everyone who has signed up for it, and I apologize if you're disappointed by the news. But the fact of the matter is, we had 2 weeks, almost more than that, if you want to get technical about it. But we had about 2 weeks of promotion, and 13 people sign up, and I value my free time. But as much as I value my free time, I value the people who are volunteering to help me, such as all my tournament admins, all my Twitch mods, all of the casters involved in the streamers, that sort of thing. I value that even more. The people at Team Liquid as well count for helping me add it to the Team Liquid calendar and whatnot. And the fact of the matter is, for 13 people, it is not worth the time, period. And if you take offense to that, please don't. It's not a personal attack, but you have to look at it from my point of view. The SS Radio Opens are our StarCraft tournaments that was started by me and organized by me. I do all the graphics and, you know, streaming and all, and the whole nine yards for that stuff. It takes a lot of free time out of my schedule to produce that. And again, I have never gained one single cent of monetary profit. I am not partnered with anybody. I do not make money off of any content that I do. However, I do have a time investment, and time is money, and that is true to the core. And on top of everything else, besides my free time, I also have to worry about people. And if I don't name you here, please don't take offense to it. I'm just rattling off names off the top of my head. But I also have to consider TGS David, who values his free time. He's a way more important and popular guy than I am. I promise you on that. As David does run the Game Station and now Polaris. or at least helps from a managerial side anyway. So TGS David is usually my head admin, and that's 6 hours of his free time on a Saturday to ask for. Crane Song, Tempo, Avos, Mr. Big Face, everyone else who is helping me mod in Twitch, and also on the admins, Ardios is another one, Worm Talon, et cetera, and Merkava, et cetera, that sort of thing. And that is a lot of people. That is a lot of time, collaborative time that I'm talking about to say, let's put on a free StarCraft tournament with I can't pay anyone. There's no prizes involved. It's just for funsies, that sort of thing, but with a professional-looking production quality. And for 13 people, again, I'm sorry, it is not worth the time investment for my sake, and more importantly, for the rest of the other volunteers' sake, for us to do that. It's bottom line, that's just how it is. And as far as I know, I know that the only question that people are going to have right now is, does this mean that the SS Radio Open tournaments are over? And the answer is no. The SS Radio Open tournaments are not over, but I feel like now is an appropriate time to probably take a break from doing it. It's very, very clear that the excitement level of StarCraft tournaments, especially ones that have really no. I don't want to say hype behind them, because all my fans, and I do have friends who also give it hype as well, but I guess no real huge attention from the StarCraft II community. It is a giant time sink, and right now I all I can say is that it's going to be a little while before you see the next SS Radio Open. Now, whether or not it's going to be this year or, you know, the start of next year, I have no idea. But right now, producing SS Radio content for the SS Radio Open is not going to be a wise use of my time, and that is about as cliche and PR as I can get to it without going into great detail. But it does require a big time investment for me, and even though we had great numbers, we had, I think, concurrently a couple hundred people watching across four streams. My stream peaked at 180 during the final four on my stream for the SS Radio Open number four. That is a lot of people. That's a lot of people who are willingly sitting there watching a gold and under tournament with no money on the line. They're not watching professional casters. They're not watching MLG or WCS or anything like that. It is just people watching it for fun, and it garnered a lot of interest. And I thought that the SS Radio Open number 5 would have ridden that momentum going into its actual play date, and I was wrong, and I don't know if it was due to the fact that the league restrictions were only going to be diamond and platinum. Again, I knew I was expecting a lower turnout as far as players wise are concerned, because it was such an exclusive restriction on the signups. Again, it was platinum and diamond. That was it. No masters, no gold or under. It was just platinum and diamond. That was y'all's time to shine, and it did not work. Again, don't blame yourselves. If you want to blame anyone, I guess blame me. I will take full responsibility for canceling the SS Radio Open number 5. I will take full responsibility for the fact that it did not fill up. And that's pretty much all I can do. I can just say sorry. I hope this does not discourage you from playing StarCraft. I hope it does not discourage you from signing up for the next SS Radio Open. But you have to look at this from a mature, realistic side of things. And I refuse to ask for the free time for a combined total of about 100 free hours of many people's free time who are doing it on a Saturday for me to put on a product such as the SS Radio Open for 13 people to sign up. It is not worth the time. It is not worth the production and everything like that. It's just simply not worth the time. And don't take that the wrong way. Don't think that I am dumping on Diamond or Platinum League players. It's not like that. It simply means that the SS Radio Open number 5 Platinum and Diamond tournament is not a good use of my time for 13 players than asking forecasters, you know, 4 to 5 tournament admins, all my Twitch mods to donate their free time on a Saturday. Is for 13 people is not going to happen. So I do apologize about that. No, the SS Radio Open is not over, but I am going to be taking a break from it. Whether or not the SS Radio Open, the real SS Radio Open number 5, will happen before the end of this year, I have no idea. All I can say is continue to play StarCraft, continue leveling, continue to get better, and that way you are ready for the next SS Radio Open when I call for it. But what I will say is that the next SS Radio Open will not be before before the end of November, so at least about another month and a half or so before I will even start to think about doing another StarCraft II tournament, and that is just how it goes. Moving on here to the second topic, a little bit more less serious, more funsy bit for SS Radio number 93. I'm going to be talking about the video that Husky and I just produced this afternoon. It was something that a fan had brought to my attention, And I later found out through a couple people sending me YouTube messages because apparently, well, you know how nerds go on the internet. The internet is a fickle nerd, and of course, everybody wanted to assume that I was taking full credit for finding out this little trick. It's not even an exploit. It's not even a clever use of game mechanics, because no one in their right mind would ever do this in an actual real match. But of course, the internet being the fickle nerd it was, I was getting angry nerd messages from people on YouTube saying, oh, some guy named, I don't even remember what his name was, I think Knox or something, he was like, oh, you guys copied this, you shouldn't take credit for this, it was Herpa Derpa Derpa, he did it days ago, Derpa. And wishing no disrespect to the man, sorry, I have not heard of you, and it was brought to my, I don't know the video that people were talking about, but it was just brought up to my attention by somebody who apparently saw it on MMO Champion, and then I was reading posts on that forum trying to figure out how exactly they actually get a 1 billion value card, and saw that, oh, okay, so you just need Lore Walker Cho, and both players are working collaboratively, and they're just spamming Divine Spirit over and over again. Basically what happens is Lore Walker Cho is a 1/4 card that you can play, I think, for 3 mana. He might be 2. He's a completely useless card in the actual game. But his mechanic is that whenever a spell is casted by either player, a copy of that spell is put into the other player's hand. So, for example, if he was playing in a real game and I'm a warlock taking on a priest, the priest casts Smite on somebody, I would then get a copy of Smite in my hand. If I were to cast Shadowbolt against that priest in the same scenario, he would get a copy of Shadowbolt in his hand thanks to Lore Walker Cho's mechanics. It's a completely useless card, okay? But what it does, you need two priest players in order to do this. And what happens is you basically buff Lore Walker Cho by an exponential value. I guess it's just squared over and over again, because what Divine Spirit does is that it doubles the amount of health that a minion has. So Lore Walker Cho, who starts at 1/4, Husky and I buffed it to, I think it was up to 32, I think, before we actually started doubling it, and then it just starts squaring over and over again. It got out of control really, really, or not squaring, I'm sorry, it starts a doubling out of control really quickly. So 32, 64, 128, etc., 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 etc. And at the end of everything, what you're supposed to do is you're supposed to use Inner Fire, which matches the attack of that minion's card with its health value. So theoretically, you could have a card, which is going to be Lore Walker Cho in this case. Theoretically, you could have a card that would have 1.something billion. And yes, I said B as in billion. 1.something billion hit points and 1.something billion attack. And then, of course, that's more than overkill. That's not even like incredible overkill. This is atrocious overkill. And it would, of course, one shot the hero or one shot whatever thing that was in there. And then that's that. Again, it's for demonstration purposes only. But accidentally, Husky and I actually broke the client. We did find out that Blizzard stores their integers in a 32-bit, structure, if you want to consider that, infrastructure. And for those of you who don't know basic programming out there, there is a limit to the amount of integers that can be produced by a 32-bit client, and that integer is somewhere between 2.2 and 2.4 billion. I'm not a programmer. Look, there's tons of nerds out there who are posting it on the comments on YouTube. Don't believe anything you see, but I do know of it because I used to do programming. Or at least I used to fail at programming. And for 32-bit clients, it does cap out at somewhere between 2.2 and 2.4 billion as far as the integer character before it actually regresses and go to negative. Now, if you watch the end of that video, and of course, don't watch it right now because you're listening to SS Radio, but if you do listen to it and you will find out that after Lore Walker Cho achieved over 1 billion health, I decided that I was going to try to double it again before I attacked Husky. And I actually unknowingly and accidentally went over that limit, and Lore Walker chose self-destructed. So what I said in the video was you basically divided by zero, and that actually is almost correct. Because what happened is that with a 32-bit client, the hit points went from 1. Whatever billion it was to negative 2-point-something billion due to the integer thing with 32-bit clients, yada, yada, yada. And Lore Walker chose, basically, he imploded on itself. And Husky and I got a really, really great laugh out of that, and then I just ended up one-shotting Husky with a 40-40 Lightwell, which actually does happen in the game, by the way. I have been one-shot by Lightwells, which is very, very dumb. But we did find out a little bit something about Hearthstone that none of us expected, which was we found out how they store their characters. And it was a lot of fun. But again, for those of you who are looking to say, "Oh, you're taking credit for something that someone else did," get over yourself, angry nerd. It's not what's happening. And again, wishing no disrespect to the person, I think his name was Knox something. It was Knox plus something, something like that. I am unfamiliar with that person, and I'm unfamiliar with the video that they are talking about. Again, it was brought to attention by a fan of mine because they do know that I am in the closed beta of Hearthstone. And I said, "Yeah, that looks hilarious. Let's see if Husky and I can do it." And then that's what happened. So yeah, and Manal said so much power he exploded. That's pretty much what happened. He went from 1-point-something billion to negative 2-something billion, which, of course, is less than zero, and then he just imploded on itself. It was absolutely hilarious. But check it out. I will leave a comment, or I will leave a direct link to that video below here in the info box on YouTube, and it's a lot of fun. Definitely check it out. And, yes, I did record from my point of view. Whether or not I'm going to post it on my YouTube, I don't know yet. It seems a little bit redundant, as most people who do follow me and subscribe to my YouTube channel usually come from Husky anyway, and I don't want to spam them with the same video except from a different point of view, but we'll see. We will see. Moving on to the next topic, I'm going to be giving you my in-depth analysis and impressions on Final Fantasy 14. Now, I do know, and people wanted to, even before I started talking about Final Fantasy on SS Radio, I got a couple of DMs from fans on Twitter who asked me what I thought about Lewis from the Yogg's Cast, saying that the game was was dog doo doo. That's about as nice as I can be with it, because this is a PG show. It's beyond PG-13 show, some kind of like that. And Lewis basically said that the game was awful and the servers were terrible. The service was awful, and that was pretty much it. A lot of people were asking, was it really that bad? And of course, Lewis having hundreds of thousands of followers and the Yogg's Cast being as huge as they are, they don't answer that kind of thing. People were asking me, did I agree with them? Do I still think the game is good, or do I think it's awful? And I can honestly say that, and this is coming from a Final Fantasy XI a veteran, let's put it that way. I played Final Fantasy XI for years, and I even had a couple of people asking me, a couple of my real-life friends asked me, they didn't believe me that when I told them how long I played and how rare it was for a North American player such as myself on the launch server Bahamut back in Final Fantasy 11 to have a full suit of AF2 armor. Now, if you don't know what that is, it's artifact armor, and I played a Dragoon. And back in Final Fantasy 11, Dragoons were considered a laughingstock. They got nerfed so hard. They used to be the class that could solo anything, and you weren't supposed to solo anything in Final Fantasy 11 past the first three or four levels. And Dragoons got nerfed hard. One of their main attacks called Pentastrike, or Pentathrust, or was it Pentastrike? I think it was Pentathrust was the actual name of the move. I think it's Pentathrust. That got incredibly nerfed, and then people just laughed at Dragoons. Well, you know me, I do not listen to what anybody tells me. I do not. If you tell me that a class sucks, I'm going to make it work. If you tell me that you can't PvP as a protection warrior, I will PvP as a protection warrior. If you tell me that Dragoons are hilariously awful, I will play a Dragoon just to spite you because I like playing by my own rules. So I stuck it out and was really the only Dragoon that you would see. And what ended up happening was that I was one of the first North American players on the server that I launched out, that I launched with on Final Fantasy XI to have a full suit of AF2 armor for the Dragoon. And And that is something that was very, very rare. And anytime I would log in, I would have millions of people who were playing. And by the way, in Final Fantasy XI, when I say North America players, the servers were all based in Japan. And the same holds true for the most part on Final Fantasy XIV until very, very recently, where they opened up North American servers with the launch of a Realm Reborn. Anyway, to sum it all up, you were playing with Japanese players and North American players. That's basically how that went. And so I was telling my buddies this. They said, no way, no proof, no proof, no proof. And then I showed them a screenshot that I took many, many years ago. This is immediately following the exact moment that I actually completed my AF2 armor, and I just linked it in chat right there. I'm not going to link it on YouTube because I do not, that is hosted on my server, and I don't want to overload the server. But that is what Final Fantasy was to me. That was Final Fantasy XI, raiding, getting the super duper hard to get gear, looking like a badass, the whole nine yards. That is what Final Fantasy XI is to me. Knowing all of this, knowing now that you're talking to a Final Fantasy XI veteran, I will say that Final Fantasy XIV is a worthy successor and follow-up to Final Fantasy XI. It is that good. And again, people saying, well, if Lewis says it's bad, then obviously it's bad, derpa, derpa, derpa. For once, nerds, I say think for yourself. And again, I'm a huge Yogscast fan. I watch the channel all the time. I like Simon. I like Lewis. I would love to meet them. I think that would be like a dream come true. Think for yourselves. Just because somebody who is very well known in the community says that the game is bad, maybe they didn't like it, judge for yourself. Try it out. As much people as want out there who want to hate on the game, I am more inclined to give it praise. And there not all the big personalities in the community are hating the game. People such as and I'm not big in the community, but are a big personality, but people such as Tally, who has made Final Fantasy XIV his new MMO, he's a very, very successful and popular guy on Twitch. He loves the hell out of the game. And he's actually, I think he's on his way to hitting 50 tomorrow when the servers come back up. It is an excellent game. It is very, very polished compared to what it was. And yes, I did play the vanilla release of Final Fantasy XIV, and it was garbage. It was one of the worst games I'd ever played. The UI was the worst UI I've ever seen in a game, period. Period. And what they have done, what Square has done, even after pissing everybody off with the NDA and beta, even after the rant that I went on and they didn't give me my refund, and again, elaborating what I talked about last week, which is the first impressions of Final Fantasy XIV, I owe them an apology. Squaresoft did a phenomenal job of making Final Fantasy XIV. It is certainly worth the time. I am happily, happily ready to start paying for the subscription fee, and I will happily play it because the game is good. It is very, very good. Surprisingly good. And I can't say enough about I guess the point is just because somebody who is a big personality on the internet, just because they play more games than you or they get paid to do it, just because they say they don't like it, just because an IGN review says that it's 2.3 or whatever, they rated it, whatever, think for yourself, nerds. Have a little bit of integrity and judge for yourself. Because as many people who say that the game is awful, you'll probably find as many people saying that the game is great. And then what do you do? What happens then? Are you just going to just split in half and then that's that? No. You are going to judge for yourself. And I'm saying judge for yourself. Final Fantasy is a great game. If you would like to play with me, I'm on the server Lamia, however you want to pronounce it. And right now you actually can't buy the game digitally, but if you're lucky enough to find a hardbound copy at a brick-and-mortar store, go ahead and pick it up. You can register. You can play. Square has said that they are going to be boosting the compensation for all the server issues that they've experienced at the game's re-release by giving you a free week, which, to be honest, a free 7 days of not having to pay for the game is a little bit silly. I think that they should just make it an extra month, and that's not me being entitled. That's me just being realistic. If they really wanted to do something to get more people and say, sorry, this is the second time we're re-releasing this game. We've had crippling issues from the servers because we grossly underestimated the popularity of the re-release of the game, which is a good sign, by the way. Square Enix has stated that they grossly underestimated the popularity and the amount of players that were going to be playing the re-release. So what happened with that is the servers just basically couldn't handle the influx of new players. You could create characters, but then sometimes you couldn't. You could log on to servers, and sometimes you couldn't. Sometimes the server list would be completely blank. Sometimes the start menu would be blank, and it got pretty bad. And I think that they should just say, you know what, we're just going to give you an extra free month. But that's not being me. That's not me being entitled. At least I don't think anyway. That's me just kind of being like, if they were really sorry, they would do that. So check it out. Don't listen to everyone that you hear on the internet. I still love YogsCast Lewis. I still love YogsCast Simon. Everyone involved with the YogsCast, but I disagree with his opinion on Final Fantasy. I feel like the game is awesome. I give it a 2 thumbs up and play the game if you can. Whenever they actually release the digital sales, go for it. It is worth it. Come play with me. Again, the server name is Lamia, L-A-M-I-A. Check it out. Sinvicta Divinis, I think, is the name. Sinvicta is spelled the usual way. Divinis is my last name or surname, and that's, I think, D-I-V-I-N-U-S. Something like that. Come play with me. You know I love to play with the fans. Moving on here to the other controversial topic in today's, I guess controversy-filled version of SS Radio, and Crane Song would be yelling at me right now because I'd be making fun of the British, but that's fine because they're British anyway, is the recently released patch for Path of Exile, a game that I haven't played in a little while, has introduced a new cosmetic feature to the game. And basically what it is I forgot Rotate Owls is British too, yeah. Controversy is Rotate Owls. Controversy. Basically, what Grinding Gears Games has done is that they, for the most part, have had the most, moral microtransaction system I've ever seen. Their game is certainly not pay to win, and it still is not. But recently, what they've done is they've added a microtransaction in the game that allows you to purchase a cosmetic item that creates little Razer logos for the Razer Corporation. And yes, it is. I'm talking about that green three-headed snake logo that they use, which kind of looks like a swastika, which is hilarious in itself. And that is now in the game. That is something that you can do in the game. And someone told me that they're free. Other people said that, no, it's actually a microtransaction. So I'm getting mixed signals on that. But anyway, the bottom line is it's in the game, and nerds are angry about it. And you can pretty much figure out what the argument is. Oh, Grinding Gear Games is selling out. They're all of a sudden Blizzard. Derp, 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 derp. And that's basically how the argument is going to be right now. People are saying that Grinding Gear Games has lost their focus. They used to be the cool, hip, indie developer, which they're not, and they never were, because they are a very, very successful multi-million-dollar company who made a stellar game. The game is still stellar. It's a phenomenal, phenomenal game as Path of Exile. But people wanted to know my thoughts on it, and this is my thoughts. This is business. I look at it from two different perspectives. I look at it as a player's perspective, and then I look at it from a realistic kind of sort of business side, entrepreneurial side, if you want to even call it that. From a player's aspect, I think it's stupid. I think it does not serve any purpose in the game. You know, what's stopping Grinding Gears Games from saying, hey, pay $2.99 and you could own this Coca-Cola helmet, or for an extra $3.50, you could have a Red Bull shield, or a McDonald's chest piece, or chicken nugget, you know, spear, or whatever. And I think that kind of commercialism is definitely inappropriate, even especially talking about the dark undertones of that is Path of Exile. It was campy to see, you know, a Pepsi sign back in the 80s whenever you were playing the Ninja Turtles arcade game. That was awesome. I used to sit there and stare at the Coca-Cola logo, and I don't remember the other game that I used to see that in. Or even if you want to talk about Yo Noid for Domino's, I used to be like, oh my god, there's actually something that I know. It's in the video game. It's relatable. I'm a kid. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But now as I look at it, it really is. I do feel like it's inappropriate, but I also don't think that the anger that it's drawing from all these nerds on the internet is warranted. And I think people really need to get over themselves as far as this is, we're the gamers, this is our game. You can't do this even though you're creating it and you actually made everything in the game, gamers. How many times do I have to tell you all this? You are not the owners of any game. You are renting it. You are leasing it for a price. In this case, you're not leasing it for anything. It's a free-to-play game. The developers can do whatever the hell they want with it. Do I think that it's a dumb idea to be seeing a million people walking around with green Razor logos coming out of their feet? Yes. Does it break any sort of immersion that you might have in the game? If you think an action RPG is an immersive, then sure, why not? Do I think it's just a dumb idea? I think it is a really dumb idea, and it kind of sets a little bit of an inappropriate standard for Path of Exile, because again, with all joking aside, where is it going to stop? I mean, real speaking, you know, are we going to see a monster energy drink, two-handed sword? Are we going to see a Red Bull helmet graphic? I mean, you know what I'm talking about. And the fact that Grinding Gear Games did this is a little bit harrowing, just due to the fact that they made themselves out to be the cool hardcore developer, and now it's kind of like as non-hardcore Diablo 3 is. I can't buy anything for my Diablo 3 character that makes me do little Blizzard logos underneath their feet, and that's Diablo 3. And now we have Path of Exile, who says, we're going to give you a cosmetic that lets you do Razor footprints. Do I think it's dumb? Yes, I do. Again, bottom line, do I think it's dumb? Yes. Do I agree with the people getting mad over it? No. I think people need to grow up a little bit. Developers will always do stuff that people are just going to have a problem with. People on the internet, people in the world, will always have something to complain about, no matter what it is, no matter what it's over. People will still complain. They will find a reason to complain about everything. And I go back to my point that says, listen, nerds and nerdettes out there, gamers of the entire world, listen, you do not own your games. Unless you created it, unless you developed it, you don't own it. If you paid money to play a game, you are renting it in this day and age. They have the right, and it's even explicitly put out and spelled out in the EULA, the End User License Agreement, that they can change their IP to whatever they want. And legally, yes, that is true. Do I agree with it? No. Do I agree with people getting angry over it? No. It's a stupid little footprint. Yeah, it breaks any sort of immersion in the game, but in the end, is it going to make Path of Exile a worse game? Are you going to stop playing because the guy that you party with has a Razor logo under it? It shouldn't, and if you do, you're just shallow and fickle. Get mad, nerds. That's what I'm telling you. You do not own this game, especially a free-to-play game. You are renting it. You are a renter. You are leasing the game. You are nothing more than a customer. That is it. They can choose to change the service whenever you want, and you are just going to have to grow up and deal with it. Here, last and finally, but certainly not least, Versus Radio number 93 are going to be cutting this show a little bit shorter today than usual, because I do have a lot of stuff to do for Mr. H.T. Husky and other things as well. I am here to announce that I have found a freelance artist who's going to start doing graphical work for me, and it is going to be, you're going to start seeing some of those pieces of art very, very soon. You're going to see it on SS Radio. You will see it on my YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook pages as well. And I do want to thank everyone who has submitted their portfolios and their auditions into the freelance artist, casting calls, if you want to call it that. Again, it's not a paid position. I'm not paying this guy to do it, but he is a mutual friend of me and CJ's. And CJ, of course, is also known as Slitz von Locust, who is also, you may know him as, the fighting games correspondent here for SS Radio. And his name is Rungs. I don't know if he actually wants me to give out his real name on the air. That's actually not something I've talked to them about. But he goes by the handle Rungs on the internet, R-U-N-G-Z. He does phenomenal work for really no gain at all. Now, he does have a couple of projects coming down the line, which I'm not at liberty to talk about right now, but you can expect to see his work on a lot of my videos and a lot of my shows very, very soon. And then when the time is right, I will start giving him promotion for his big project, and it's going to be awesome. It's going to be awesome. But again, congratulations to Rungs. I do want to thank everyone who has sent me all the artistic pieces and portfolios. If you weren't selected, that does not mean that I don't want to hear from you. If you think that you've got something better, send it in. I love watching art. I love looking at art. And for those wondering, no, I didn't actually get any sort of freelance musicians offering their services, which is understandable because music is debatably harder to produce than some art, and I understand that. But basically what this means is that you won't be seeing any crappy logos that I do anymore. You won't be seeing any more crappy graphics that I do, at least not for the most part anyway. And someone else is going to take the reins from me, and that will free me up to do other things such as produce more content, get more videos recorded, and do fan games, and all the whole nine yards. Going to be great. And that's going to do it for us here on SS Radio number 93. Stick around for the post-game wagon adventure. Will Sorar, who apparently is a girl, even though I thought I could have swore that he was a dude. Who knows? Will Sorar be able to make it two in a row? Stick around and find out. Thank you very much for listening. Check out all the links below down here in the YouTube information box. I will see you Thursday evening. Same bat time, same bat channel. Good night now.